So welcome. This is for me really, I think the intersection, the culmination of several different circles in my life. So I'm looking at these faces and what this symbolizes, and it's a lot. We've been talking about having my father come for a long time, actually, since some of my first days here, and talking to Al and Peggy and saying, okay, we're gonna get your dad over here. You know, that's the first thing. And now that this is happening, I'm reflecting back on those times and what this means for me. You know, when I was younger, he got me into a Balinese gamelan. You know, that was some of his influences, and from living there with my mom, you know, I'd been hearing about Bali for years and Balinese things and how they used to pretend to cook Balinese food for Al and Peggy. He did tell you that wasn't a real recipe, right? And just this past summer, we actually made it to Bali, and so that was sort of the closing of one of these arcs. And at the same time, I was here and I was living here, this life that was really separate from anything that you know my life had been in Swarthmore. And now that he's here, after Bali, after with people that are from Swarthmore that I've seen my whole life, it's a lot. And I think it's great, and it shows what the spirit of tonight's talk is about: East meeting West, and about our world getting smaller and smaller and smaller. So I'm really glad that you're all here to share this with me, to share this with us. Even if you weren't here, it would be really just as meaningful to me. So. I'd like to introduce my dad. Please give him a warm round of applause.
So I think I'll just play some music. I'll just let it go, and I'll sit down, and we'll all listen together. This is obviously very meaningful for me to be here. I hope that after this long wait for me to come give this talk until the week that Adam's actually leaving here, that it doesn't turn out to be a huge anticlimax. Now, this subject matter, as I really reminded myself when preparing what to bring for this talk, is vast. And I became immersed, submerged in this whole question of composers working in some way cross-culturally, and there are many ramifications of it, I became deeply immersed in a marvelous book on the subject, which is called Musical Exoticism. Exoticism is not exactly my topic today, but it's quite closely relevant, by a leading music historian, Ralph Locke. So I recommend that book to you if this talk piques your curiosity at all. And unlike Ralph, I'm not a cultural historian. So that's why I carefully put in the subtitle of my talk, A Composer's View. I'm take a rather pragmatic, hands-on view of how composers imagine sounds, how composers put sounds together, and what imaginative sources stimulate composers' creative imagination. And I can say it's been my experience firsthand, and I'm hardly alone among contemporary composers, to find that a lot of the music that we imagine is in response to other music. This has always been true of composers, and I'm very interested when I look at what composers do about looking at what was in their ear in terms of other pre-existing music. And nowadays, that can be from a huge variety of sources. The term world music has come into common usage. And for example, at the time I was in college, the Nonesuch record company started a series called the Explorer Series, which was a revelation to many of us composers. They sent people out to various countries, and they did field recordings that were often excellently done. They varied. Some of them were rather superficial, but many of them were excellent. And now a lot of their best ones have been reissued on CD, and they do stand the test of time. So a wider range of music was in the air during my formative years than used to be the case. But as I hope to give at least some samples to show you that this has always been the case to some degree. And this is off the topic of my talk, but the origins of Western European music go back to music for the church and plain chant or Gregorian chant that goes back well over 1,000 years. And I'm going to use a few musical terms in this talk. One of them is texture. We use the word texture to mean how sounds are put together in a piece of music and how many different independent musical thoughts are going on at a time. Plain chant is a single line melody. There's no harmony, there's no counterpoint, there's only one pitch sounding at a time, and the curves that are made by the continuities of those pitches make melodic lines. So the single melodic line we call monody or monophonic music. And most of the world's music was and still is monophonic music, single line music. All the traditions of the Islamic world, Arabic classical music, Turkish music, Persian music, are all single line monophonic traditions. At most, there might be a drone, a single fixed pitch accompanying, and there is often percussion or music of indefinite pitch to establish rhythmic profiles and metrical structures. But in terms of actual fixed pitches, they're single line musics. So that will come into play in some of the examples I'm going to show you. Now, Gregorian chant, recent research has suggested the way it may have been performed 1,000 years ago may not have been in this pure, sort of white-toned, clean, sacred-sounding tone of voice that we associate with Gregorian chant. It may have had a lot more bending of pitches and ornaments in a way that when people perform it in that way, it's a speculative performance practice, sounds quite Middle Eastern. So thinking of Gregorian chant as possibly sounding a lot more continuous with Eastern traditions is already very provocative. But I'm going to start this story a little bit later. When you could postulate a clear division of cultures, Western European culture and cultures that Westerners would consider other. And so the first example of this is the really intense fascination in 18th century Europe, particularly in the classical tradition centered around Vienna, the classical tradition of Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven, the latter half of the 18th century, this fascination with Turkish music. The Ottoman Empire was a strong presence in Europe, and I am not a historian, but I know that there was a siege of Vienna in 1685, and the sound of the military band music of the elite Turkish troops called the Janissaries, the military band music was called Meter, was heard a great deal in Europe. And I'm not sure once that invasion was repelled, how present that military band music was over the next 100 years. And the best explanation I've seen of it in some writings about the subject is that the memories of that military band music remain very strong. So there are many operas on particularly Turkish subjects or with Turkish or other Middle Eastern characters. And the most famous among those is Mozart's opera, The Abduction from the Seraglio, which is a story of four Western Europeans who are find themselves lost and, in fact, captive in the palace of a Turkish pasha. So let me start with a couple of samples of Turkish military band music. You have on your faculty here the world's leading expert on Ottoman classical music, and I'm most regretful that he can't be here for this talk, Zev Feldman. But he tells me that we have very little idea what the actual military band music that the Europeans heard actually sounded like. The music of the Mehter was discontinued in 1826, and the tradition that survives now was the revived tradition from much later in the 19th century. So this may or may not sound very much like what Mozart would have heard or what Mozart would have heard about. But this is what we have. So here's a sample of Turkish military band music. Characteristics are that it's very loud, noisy music. It's a single line melody, which is played by a whole ensemble of trumpets and oboes, very pungent sounding melody instruments, with a great array of different sized drums punctuating the rhythm, and cymbals, and other ringing metallic percussion. There was something they called the Turkish crescent, which was a bunch of small bells on a pole that were shaken, otherwise known as the jingling Johnny in Europe, which is, well, we'll see what that sounds like. So here's, brace yourself. Do we have sound? Let me point out something else here. One thing that's very characteristic of these marches is that they have very simple repeating rhythmic patterns. And one of the things you'll see that European composers pick up on are those type of things. So this one, if you listen to the bass drum, you'll hear it makes a long, short, short, long, short, short pattern that's repeated. Here's another example in a slightly faster tempo, which uses a different rhythmic pattern, which is short, short, long, short, short, long. This one, wait, this one.
Astur. Haydi. Ya Allah.
Ya Allah. I believe the purpose of this music was to instill terror in your enemies. And maybe I should crank it up louder. In this example, you can hear the difference between the timbres of the melody instruments, because if you hear the trumpets and the oboes together first, and then the trumpets drop out, and then you can just hear the oboes. I use the term oboe, but they're not really Western oboes. They're part of a general instrument class of double reed instruments we call shawms. The oboe is a kind of refined Western shawm. The Turkish name is zurna. This one has an interesting pattern that I find it difficult to imagine anybody marching to because it comes to an odd number. The pattern here is long, short, short, long, short. So it comes out to 9 beats asymmetrically arranged. Long, short. Hard to do that. Yes, it's in the guise of military band music, which I find is a little puzzling. So this may be a modern evolution of this military band music that is based on various Turkish dance rhythms, which do have asymmetrical rhythmic patterns. this next is very interesting because in most of the examples I just showed you use scale types that are not too different from European types of scales, major and minor scales. This one is in a scale that is characteristically Middle Eastern. It's common in Arabic, Turkish, Persian music, and also Eastern European folk music, such as Bulgarian, Romanian, precisely because of the Turkish influence. So I'll show you what it sounds like.
Hijaz Humayun Peshlevi.
Hijaz Humayun, he's announcing the name of this mode, this makam. Peshrev means an instrumental composition.
Haydi, ya Allah.
You can tell that has a distinctly Middle Eastern flavor to it. If a major scale goes like this, this scale has the second degree is lower. Instead of, so the distance between the second and third degree is bigger than in any Western scale. We call that an augmented second. What I found interesting is that a very easy way for a Western composer to sound Turkish would be to use the scales with the augmented seconds. And in the 18th century, they just don't. And so I'm quite curious about why they didn't. It became, in the 19th century, it became a very obvious trope to sound exotic, to sound oriental, to depict the other, use augmented seconds. But in the time of Mozart and Haydn, they just didn't do that. Here's another scale like this. This one has the augmented second in a different place. So this scale is, it has the augmented second between the first and second scale degrees, and then the third. So using exotic or different modal or scale types would be, I don't know what just happened, would be one obvious way to take on an Eastern European coloring, but they didn't really do that. So here's what it sounds like. This is the overture to Mozart's Abduction to the Seraglio. And because he's Mozart, he's not just anybody, he uses the standard Turkish tropes very cleverly. It begins with the orchestra playing softly in a what you might call classical style. And he reserves the Turkish percussion and the insistent Turkish-type rhythms for four bars in, so they catch you by surprise. Oops, that's not Mozart. Here we go, sorry. Okay, this is Mozart, we know Mozart. It's almost a culture clash in the first eight bars of this overture. Short, long. So some of the things that became Turkish markers, Turkish tropes, Turkish cliches, which had only some degree of relationship to actual Turkish music, were simple repeated patterns like that. Obviously, the sound of the percussion, that is the single most marked Turkish signpost. Also, simple harmony that doesn't move very much. a kind of shrill wind instrumentation using the piccolo that you heard in there. So that's not a typical 18th century orchestral sound. That's a special kind of brash sound that's supposed to evoke a little bit about the brashness of the Turkish military band music. I noticed that when that theme comes back at the end of the abduction overture, there's a subtle difference. For that soft music, the part that didn't sound Turkish, Mozart adds the triangle in so that it blends the Turkish sound with the percussion, with the non-Turkish sounding music. That's the kind of thing that Mozart would think of. Little tiny hint of the Turkish sound the second time you hear the theme, but not the first. There are two choruses of the Janissaries in the Abduction from the Seraglio. And in the first of them, he does indulge a bit in exotic scale types. This is rare. He doesn't go so far as to use augmented seconds, but that's our major scale. If you raise the fourth degree, that's an exotic marker in 18th century music. So this chorus uses that sharp four rather prominently, and that's a very exotic sound in Mozart's time. It sounds like this. And in the finale, the very last few minutes of the abduction from the seraglio, the Turkish sounding percussion accompanies the final chorus of the Janissaries, and you'll see that one of the characteristic Turkish tropes is to reduce the texture to unison. To monody, in other words. You see that at a certain point in here, there's no harmony or bass line. So that's a sort of a Turkish marker. The other really interesting thing that nobody has noticed that wrote about this music that I've read, is that he seems to have been hearing the asymmetrical meters, like that march I played for you before in a 9 beats. Because this phrase that you're about to hear has 13 beats, and then when it's repeated, two of them are cut off, and it makes 11. So the pattern, if you sum it up, goes long, 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 and then you have this pattern, short, short, long, repeated 5 times. This is really goes against all the classical norms of balanced phrase structure. So it's subtle, but especially to 18th century ears, this would have been highly exotic. So this is 1782. This was a hugely popular, extremely famous work, and it uses, there are other Turkish touches in it. There are arias for the one of the two principal Turkish characters, Osman, which have many Turkish aspects to those also. Now the interesting thing is that the Turkish style didn't necessarily require all that banging percussion. Some of the other aspects of it could be incorporated in music that doesn't have actually any of those sounds. And it was codified as a manner that was called a la Turca. And any of you who know Mozart might already know what I'm talking about. So I'm going to massacre a little bit of the Mozart A major sonata, which begins with a set of variations on this extremely graceful theme. And then it has a second movement, which is a very, again, graceful, almost courtly minuet. So it's a bit of a shock when the finale turns out to be this. Long, long, short, short, long, 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 short, short, long. Same rhythm as one of the first of those marches. And especially the second theme in major. Practically hear the jingling Johnny in the triangle. So this piece is universally known as the Rondo a la Turca, but it is not a rondo, and it doesn't say that in the score. But it does say a la Turca. So that tells the player, you know this style, you know the Turkish manner, do it that way. So that shows how well established it was. Here's another really interesting example. I think this is a piece that really has a culture clash built into it. Mozart's fifth violin concerto, which is earlier than any of these pieces that I've just talked about. The last movement is also a graceful minuet, begins this way. In triple time minuet. Then the invasion happens. Turns to minor, turns to duple time, march tempo. This actually sounds more Hungarian than Turkish. Then the Turks come. Now's the Turkish invasion. That mixes in the most simple, rudimentary, rude harmony with some of Mozart's most sophisticated, disturbing chromatic harmony. I also think it's interesting. I don't know if this is intended to be a symbol of primitivism, but the theme is a palindrome. It sort of runs forwards and then backwards. It's like a mirror. It goes up and then down. And especially the other part runs exactly backwards. This is all very strange. And this music is like something out of nowhere. It comes from another planet. It breaks into that minuet and fades back into the minuet. I have a million examples of this type of thing to show you, but I want to touch on other topics. It's a little irresistible, though, not to play this one. This is Haydn's so-called military symphony, the second movement of it. It's this very innocent tune. Then this happens. It turns to minor suddenly, and it turns Turkish, and all sorts of interesting things happen. And the greatest of them is the end of the movement. It alternates the major music and the minor music, and then you think you're all done, and then this happens. The trumpet plays this fanfare out of nowhere. So that's a kind of Western call to battle, I guess. Among the things that I turned up looking for examples of this was a quite obscure piece of Beethoven's called The Ruins of Athens. This is a incidental music he wrote for a play, which includes some Turkish elements in the plot, and it has a Turkish march in it, which is actually, I didn't know what this was. This is a tune that lots of people know. It's Beethoven's Turkish march. That long, long, short, short, long. You're getting the idea about these sort of standardized Turkish tropes. This represents a procession, and Beethoven handles this Turkish prototype with a lot of wit. You see, it starts off soft and delicate. When it further along, I'm going to skip ahead here. As they approach, it gets louder with the Turkish percussion. Still. Then when it fades out, it predictably gets softer. And there's a wonderful witty touch here, very subtle. The harmony goes awry. It goes a little wonky for a moment. It makes me think he's not only making the band disappear, he's making a joke out of it. Of the hat to finish. But then I found this piece, which people do know that tune. People don't even know what it was. It's sort of one of Beethoven's really popular tunes. He even wrote variations on it for piano himself. There is a chorus of dervishes in this same Ruins of Athens. This seems to me the farthest excursion into the exotic of any of these composers of this period. Oh, I should tell you what they're singing, actually. I got a translation. It's a text of probably garbled Islamic phrases. You have carried the moon in the folders of your sleeve and have split it. Kaaba, yes, the Kaaba. Muhammad. You have climbed upon the shining steed Borak, not Borat, Borak, and have flown off to the seventh heaven, great prophet. Kaaba. You will hear them shouting over and over again, Kaaba. This is really, in a German text, this is quite strange. Turkish percussion. Can we boost this a little bit? Kaaba. I don't think anyone would guess this was Beethoven if you didn't know. I play this for my colleagues who are very sophisticated musicians. Among other things, there's this bare unison texture, which is completely atypical for Beethoven. Secondly, every note has a trill on it. There's this constant ornamentation, which is, I think, an effort to evoke the highly ornamented style of Middle Eastern music, and is a trope that later 19th century romantic composers like Rimsky-Korsakov, for example, used very readily to sound Middle Eastern. But this is 1811, before any of those guys had even thought about being born. Finally, it uses an exotic scale with a sharp four again. That note is quite exotic sounding. I've never heard anything else like it in Beethoven, and it goes farther than Mozart, Haydn, or any of the other composers that were really interested in this Turkish thing. It's an extraordinary. This is a great leap forward, if not a great leap eastward, it's a great leap forward into later 19th century Orientalism. Then there's this tune you may have heard. The Ode to Joy theme from Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. There's a passage in which that tune is varied. It's given a different rhythm, which is commonly called the Turkish March from Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. So this is the 1820s. This is long after this fad had passed, not so long after Beethoven wrote The Ruins of Athens, when he was clearly thinking Turkish. It's a Turkish march, it's a dervish chorus. So there can be very little doubt that for Beethoven, this type of music, particularly this percussion scoring, had Turkish connotations. Extraordinary. Is this a joke or the sudden entrance of this Turkish march? There's a contrabassoon sort of burping down below, you can't hear it. Okay, so that's the European Turkish thing. There are a lot of other topics that I could touch on, and I can't do justice to them all, so I will mention the things that I'm not going to talk about. Chinoiserie, the fascination for things Japanese and Chinese in the later 19th century, and the exhibit A for this is Puccini's opera Turandot, which is an entirely Chinese story and uses a Chinese folk song quite conspicuously. I was interested to read that very song has now been banned from the internet in China because political protesters were using it on their cell phones. I guess I should show you that. This is too good not to show you that. The tune goes like this. Tune. It goes on. It's called Jasmine Flower. It has a long history in China. It's first sung by a children's chorus in Turandot. I'll say something about the tune first of all. This is in a scale type which is an immediate identifier for Western composers of trying to sound Far Eastern, what we call the pentatonic scale. If we take a major scale, it has seven different notes. If we leave out the fourth and seventh, we have gaps. So we call it a gap scale. Just 1, 2, 3, 5, 6. Particularly the skip from 6 up to 1 is a particularly anti-Western thing because it leaves out the note that makes our harmonic system most powerful, which is what we call the leading tone. If you don't have the power of the leading tone with its need to resolve from the tonic, you have weakened the sense of tonal harmony, the sense of directedness that's at the core of what makes Western European music work. So that scale is a already something other. So this is the interesting thing is that when Puccini harmonizes it, he doesn't try to make it normal and tonal, but he also doesn't just restrict himself to the notes of the scale that the melody is in. He does this. So the harmony also doesn't use a leading tone. It doesn't, he could have done this. I'm sorry, Puccini, forgive me. If you wanted to normalize it with functional tonal harmony, you would do something like that. Or maybe something a little better, but something along those lines. So the harmony is exotic, what we call modal, but it uses notes that are not in the melody. And this is what it sounds like. Oh. Not long after this, it's sung in triumph for the arrival of the princess to her daughter. So the pentatonic scale does give me a sort of a link to our next topic. In 1889, at the International World's Fair in Paris, the young composer Claude Debussy, who had written very little of the music that really sounds like his mature voice yet, only a few songs really sound like mature Debussy. He was in his late 20s. Was a rapt listener to music of the Indonesian gamelan, or percussion orchestra, from Java. Now, it is somewhat known exactly what sort of Javanese music was played there. I've been in correspondence with a French amateur music historian who's collected every possible recording of documents about what actually was at that World's Fair. It probably didn't sound exactly like contemporary central Javanese court gamelan, but that's what I'm going to play you, because that's the best we can do. And some of the things in this music clearly do have echoes in Debussy's music. It does use a pentatonic scale similar to the one that I just showed you. So what you have is an orchestra of various sized metallic percussion instruments. They're of two types, keyed instruments, which the closest Western equivalent is the vibraphone, flat metal keys with resonating tubes underneath, and gong chimes. Those are gongs with knobs on them that have specific notes. And there are big, deep gongs that punctuate the big, larger rhythmic periods of this music. There are also melody instruments. There's a fiddle, there are flutes, and there are occasionally there are wooden keyed xylophones and zithers, pluck string instruments, that are also part of the texture. So this is a sample of Javanese music. The big court gamelans come in two styles. They call them loud style and soft style. So this is a bit of loud. It's an extremely dense, multi-layered music. Based on a steady succession of what they call trunk tones or skeleton tones, and lots of faster notes filling in the texture, actually varying those melodic lines. If you listen very closely here, the trunk tones are going this fast. There are eight fast notes in me, tucka 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 tucka, between each trunk tone and the next. There are also parts that move slower than that. There are different speeds going at the same time. This is a little bit later, where there are 16 notes to the trunk tone, later in the same piece. this is an example of more of the soft style. Yeah, I'll skip to this one. In the soft style, you can hear the pluck string instrument and the xylophone more. They're instruments that either don't play or you can't hear them in the loud style. Could this be a little louder? Let's go ahead. You feel like you enter into this enchanted world with all sorts of stuff going on that you can't quite hear. Voices add to the mix. Debussy was enchanted by this music. He wrote about it again and again for years afterwards. He said, for example, referring to the Javanese, there used to be, indeed, despite the troubles that civilization has brought, there still are, some wonderful peoples who learn music as easily as one learns to breathe. That's entirely wrong. This music is the product of intense and prolonged study. Never mind. Their school consists of the eternal rhythm of the sea, the wind in the leaves, and 1,000 other tiny noises which they listen to with great care without ever having consulted any of those dubious treatises. Debussy was against harmony textbooks. Their traditions are preserved only in ancient songs, sometimes involving dance, to which each individual adds his own contribution century by century. Thus, Javanese music obeys laws of counterpoint that make Palestrina seem like child's play. There were other remarks about it. He was haunted by this music. So one thing that's I'll play the beginning of the piece that is kind of exhibit A, as the one that everyone talks about as showing the most overt gamelan influence, and it's called Pagode or Pagodas. It's the first of his estampes for piano or prints from 1903. It begins with a gong stroke, the low bass. It even does something. I'll take a moment to demonstrate this before I show you the Debussy. The gong periods are punctuated by the deepest gongs that play the least often, and their periods are subdivided by higher pitched gongs. So you could say, I'll just make up some notes here to represent gongs. Here's a low gong, here's a high gong, and here's a medium. So if you have, let's say, a short cycle of 8 beats, it might be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, which is not that interesting. But there's another layer that plays more often, but it plays on the weak beats. It's kind of syncopated. So it would go like, make sure to do this right, something like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1. So there's something a little dynamic. It's not just bum, 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 but it's bum, ba, 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 bum. The faster gongs play on the off beats, which build up a certain rhythmic tension towards the next gong. I'm taking all this trouble to point this out because I don't think anyone else has said this about the beginning of Debussy's Pagode, but I think he's mirroring that gesture in this pattern. To me, that suggests he was listening not just to the surface of the music, but to the rhythm of the gong periods underlying it. So then, that sets up the underlying framework, which is the Javanese pentatonic scale, And for long stretches, that's all this piece uses. That has the effect of completely freezing the idea of chord progressions, of harmonic movement. The music is a wash of pentatonic sound, just like gamelan is. The moving parts move in a different way, but the sound world is very clearly evocative of gamelan. The next section, I'll do better to play a recording of this. The next section is really in very pure gamelan style. Sorry, not that way, this one. Oh, I see, I have the volume down. Make a connection between that sound. The pedal is down. The notes of the pentatonic scale just resonate throughout the piano in a way that really sounds like the resonance of the gamelan. And the end of the piece is a shimmering, arpeggiated expansion of this pentatonic gamelan. I've discovered a wonderful curiosity. There's an arrangement of this piece by Percy Grainger. I don't know if any of you ever heard of Percy Grainger. He was a quite eccentric pianist and composer. And he was Australian, and he did know something about gamelan. And he worked with instrument makers to construct what he considered the Western equivalent of a gamelan, a percussion orchestra with instruments of all registers and sizes. And he made a transcription of pagode for a gamelan-like ensemble. In other words, he returned the piece to its original sources. It's quite wonderful. Doesn't really take very much to make the connection quite explicit. Now, I can play you other examples of gamelan-like sonorities, but there's other things that get more interesting. There are passages that I don't think Debussy would have, that are really characteristic, that make his music sound as original and as free of routine and Western tradition as it does. They do not sound like gamelan, but they would ever have thought of without gamelan. So I'm taking a chance to see whether I can make this audible. But in the prelude to the Afternoon of a Faun, the beginning of it is a solo flute melody that's quite famous. And not until here is there anything more than just this flute alone. Then there's the first chord in the piece. Parenthesis here. That flute melody is an archetypal example of the type of melodic line that Debussy loved the best, and he called it the arabesque. So The arabesque is a very important concept in the not only in the way Westerners viewed Middle Eastern culture. The term obviously comes from the arabesque in the graphic arts of the Islamic Middle East, the calligraphic, decorative, or floral type of geometrical curving line. And an analogy to decorative curving musical lines, that was felt very strongly by Debussy, and he liked some of Bach's very ornate melodies because he called them arabesques. So the main thematic material of the Prelude to the Afternoon of a Faun is an arabesque melody. The middle tune is more romantic, and it sounds more like a, like I say, a romantic melody. On the restatement of this melody, there's a very rich orchestral texture. I'll play it for you first, then I'll kind of dissect it. Listen to how much is surrounding this melody. Get a sense that there's things moving along at different speeds that aren't really synchronizing with one another. What's going on there is the melody is and the woodwinds are accompanying it in music, essentially, I won't try to explain the rhythm exactly. It's as if it were in another tempo, in another speed. They're actually playing in triplets. One, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, three. So they have a completely different pulsation from the melody. That already is a little bit gamelan-like, the idea of different speeds at the same time. Now, what's subtle enough that you don't quite hear it is the harp parts. The first part is doubling the woodwinds. But the other harp is doing something extremely subtle. So remember that line goes down the scale? This is what the other harp does. It's playing a very free variant of the same. Could you hear the descending scales in there? It's sort of concealed in there. That is very much the way the plucked zither in a Javanese gamelan will play its own variations of the trunk tones. It gets to the same notes, but not necessarily at the same time, and it takes its own way to get there. And what's even more Javanese about that is that in a Javanese gamelan, you can't really hear the zither unless you're sitting next to him. I had the privilege of doing that in Yogyakarta, and I thought, this is fantastic what these guys are playing. They're partly improvising. They're making up these extremely elaborate, arabesque-like curves just to contribute to the general welter of stuff that's going on. And it's not like a soloist. They don't put a mic in front and say, hey, here's your solo. You're going to hear the zither part. In the same way, you can't hear that as a thing in itself in Debussy's orchestra, but it adds to the general richness of the texture. And I think that's a very profound influence. And it makes Debussy's way of writing for orchestra really distinctive. It's different from anybody else's. And it makes his music still difficult to play. The contributions of what the individual players are doing to the whole is not straightforward. It's not obvious as it is in much other music. So Debussy felt that gamelan was not only a sound world that he wished to emulate from time to time, but it was more than that. It was liberating from the whole inherited idea of what texture was in Western music, how the different moving parts went together. And it was also liberating from the idea of harmony that had to have a sense of direction. So a static pentatonic field in which you reveled in the sounds of this wonderful, beautiful, but totally static harmonic world. It wasn't going anywhere. It was just being somewhere. That was a very profound thing, and through Debussy was a very profound influence on the rest of 20th century music, even if people had never heard of gamelan or didn't care about it. Because most composers, including Stravinsky and Bartok, who never sound like gamelan, they both said they owed more than to Debussy, they owed more than to anyone else of the preceding generation. So gamelan was really a formative thing for the entire history of Western music. What I will skip over is how many Western composers have written gamelan music and have gotten directly involved with that. I would just say that that's a particularly American thing. The circle around John Cage in the early part of the 20th century, where they had heard gamelan, they heard Chinese opera in San Francisco, which is another kind of percussion orchestra, and a whole counter tradition to the European-based tradition. Lou Harrison, one of the leading composers in this group, said we're interested in Pacifica rather than Atlantica. And he himself became a master of Javanese gamelan, and he even composed pieces in the traditional style for the Javanese gamelan that are part of the repertory of the palace in Yogyakarta, in the palace of the Sultan. That's an unheard of entree of an American into the most closed, formalized, aristocratic, social and artistic world. So I think for the last part of this, I want to skip ahead to a few samples of what this has meant in my own work. Let's see. My teacher Messiaen described me as a Europeanized American who had the good luck to live in Asia, which I think kind of summed it up. It was definitely luck. So I need to show you a little Balinese music first. Balinese gamelan is a first cousin to Javanese gamelan, but has a different sound world to it. So this is the kind of Balinese music that sounds the most like Javanese music. This is a very old temple style music that's used in temples, which is rather rare nowadays. It's a close resemblance to the loud style of Javanese music. This is called gong gede, or music of the great, great gongs. Gets faster and slower, which has the effect of planets changing in their orbits. It's so big. Most of these gamelans were melted down, actually, physically. The keys were melted down in the 20th century to in favor of a new more dynamic, lighter style, which is much flashier, which is called kebyar. Kebyar means an explosion or bursting forth. Here's a sample of kebyar. This is the most common form of music in Bali now. Music extreme virtuosity. The Javanese think that Balinese music is a lot of noise and flash without any substance, and the Balinese think that Javanese music is to fall asleep to. So this music was heard in a Paris World's Fair in 1931 and was imitated, quite frankly, by Francis Poulenc, and Messiaen was there, and there was a second wave of Indonesian influence in French music. The first one was Java by way of Debussy. The second one was Bali by way of a younger generation of composers. I'm going to skip them just to show a couple of samples from my music. So the first piece I wrote the first time I went to Bali was, I call this a transcription of a Balinese original, except that the original doesn't exist. It's a transcription of an imaginary Balinese piece. I called it bronze music in tribute to the bronze keys of Balinese gamelans. And it mixes a few elements of different styles. It has a kebyar-like beginning. By the way, the medium is entirely changed. This is for a band. So it's a paradox of using an orchestra of wind instruments to evoke the sound of a percussion orchestra. But here it is. I also made a version of this for two pianos, which sounds more gamelan-like. Here's the same thing. Now, this doesn't sound anything like my music before this piece. I was so inundated with Balinese music that all I could do as a composer was to try to compose it as a kind of exorcism, to get it out of my system. Instead, what I did was I got it deeper into my system, but I had fun writing the piece. The main section of it sounds like gonga day, the ceremonial music you just heard. It has this steady procession of trunk tones. Piece, it does something that you could only do in Java, which is to change the mode. The mode of this is a different kind of pentatonic scale. It's still a gap scale, it only has five notes. And what this piece does, which no gamelan in Bali would do, was it shifts to another five-note scale by trading one for another one. So it changes to that scale midway. So this is an example of Javanese music that's in that scale. This is Javanese gamelan. The pitches don't match the piano. There's nothing I can do about that. So in bronze music, we get this. This music coincidentally resembles minimalism, Steve Reich in particular. This was written in 1981. Minimalism was definitely happening then, but I wasn't listening to it at all. I was paying it no attention. It's entirely coincidence. It's not entirely coincidence. Steve Reich studied Balinese gamelan, so that's why it's not a coincidence. The next time I went back to Bali, I wrote a much more elaborate homage to Balinese music in which I took Balinese elements that were very particular to different styles, and then I really tried to take them much farther in my own way. I'll just give you a couple of samples of that. Here's an example of a very simple kind of music that's used for a dance. It's a male warrior dance, and it basically uses just 8-note figures that are repeated over and over again with a lot of changes of loud and soft, but it's basically the same trunk tones. So in this piece of mine, which I called For the Morning of the World in tribute to Bali, that was a nickname that Pandit Nehru gave to Bali, the Morning of the World, I start off by quoting that dance motif quite literally, and then you'll see I start veering off from it in all sorts of directions. A little louder, please. This could almost be a transcription. Now you see that all sorts of other musics are superimposed on this. This movement prompted a critic to wonder whether I had imagined an island where gamelans played jazz. This is another very ancient, rare tradition in Balinese music of iron-keyed gamelan, which only plays sacred music. There's nothing performance-oriented at all about this music. And it only comes from certain extremely traditional villages. It's called Selunding. This is a recording I made myself back in 1982. This may include an authentic Balinese chicken in the recording. There's a very intricate kind of counterpoint here if you listen to it. It's very rich music. It's sort of like Bach. Another sample with the chicken. So the slow movement of this suite of mine for the Morning of the World is a very distant takeoff. I tried to capture some of the feeling of it. There's an ineffable kind of nostalgic sweetness to this music that I find very haunting, and also the sense of this counterpoint that's almost too dense to quite follow. There are 6 movements. Each one of them is based on a different style. I'll give you a few seconds of the 5th movement because it's something quite different. here. There's an ensemble of bamboo-keyed xylophones playing very strange music. The bamboo plays a continuous patter of counterpoint, and there's one metal instrument that plays in a rhythm of 5+3, very odd rhythm. More to Balinese music than the typical things you're most likely to hear. So I made a little scherzo out of this that combines the dry timbres of those wooden xylophones. I use a muted piano and a marimba, and metal instruments plus winds playing the 5+3 rhythm. Like every Balinese piece, it has an introduction. I think this no longer sounds like Balinese music the way bronze music did, but I couldn't have thought of it without fairly close attention to some details of a Balinese style. Later, this movement goes a little crazy with the 5 and 3 idea. Here you have some things that are in 5 superimposed on some things that are in 3, so it's 5/3. Winds are playing 5. And I'll finish with 2 examples of something completely different. I wonder if any of you have ever heard music that sounds like this. Ritual music, which I never heard live until I went to Nepal in 1983 and heard it among the Tibetan community in Nepal. But I had records thanks to the None Such Explorer series and others. And this is back in the 70s. This really caught my attention. And several pieces of mine try to evoke not only the sound, but the feeling, the grandeur and the wildness of this Tibetan music. There are those low horns, which I became a little obsessed by. They appear in a number of my pieces. And also the raw sound of those shams playing this ornamental music. So there's a couple of samples of that. I was commissioned by the French government to write a 70th birthday tribute piece to my teacher Messiaen, who was a man of the mountains, the French Alps. So I thought I would pay tribute to him by way of a mountain music, which was Tibetan music. So it's kind of a roundabout way of paying tribute to Messiaen. But here's the beginning of my piece, which I call Chant des Rochers, or Song of the Rocks. There's an oboe solo that evokes those songs and the percussion. Later band piece of mine called Mountain Light turns the Tibetan horns, those giant bass notes, into giant chords. This is the beginning of Mountain Light. One final example is from my first symphony, Anahata. It has a Sanskrit title, and it's a profound musical influence on it is something I won't take the time to go into, which is Indian ragas. But it uses melodies that are derived from beautiful melodic modes that I heard during this time in Nepal, and which this is a big client. This is a half-hour long piece for a very large orchestra. It's a quite ambitious piece. This is one of the central climaxes when the whole orchestra comes together in a gamelan-like sound, which then spills over into a raga-like melody with the Tibetan shawm-like timbre. This is kind of putting a lot of these things together. Melodic mode they're playing in is Indian. So in Ralph Locke's book, he talks about composers who adopt the actual sounds of music from other cultures as just part of their vocabulary without necessarily trying to paint pictures of the other or the exotic that are interested in the sound materials themselves. He's coined the term transcultural composition for that, which I think I'm comfortable with that perhaps what I'm up to is a kind of transcultural composition. So I'm sorry if I've gone on too long, but if there are questions or discussion, I'd really be most eager to hear it. Thank you for your attention.
That Pierre Messiaen a eu deux rivers of students. One is your river and the other one is Pierre Boulez, and it's very different, right?
Well, one of the things that Pierre Boulez struck out in a direction of early on of trying to discover a whole new musical language that owed as little as possible to the past, and it was a highly intellectualized quest. But he relented pretty quickly about that. And one of the things that Pierre Boulez appreciated about Messiaen as a teacher was that he acquainted his students with music from all over the world. And in the 1940s, when Boulez was in his class, Messiaen took them to the Musée de l'Homme, the Anthropological Museum, to listen to their field recordings of music from Bali and Java and Japan and Africa. And the sound world of the timbres of the instruments in particular of music from those cultures was very important to Boulez. So maybe not as different as it sounds.
Have you ever worked with choreographers? Have they picked up your work? Because I kept seeing dances as I was listening.
It's been done once or twice, but after the fact, a choreographer took an existing piece of mine. But that would be exciting. Anybody interested in choreographers here? That would be really thrilling. I want to say something about that, actually. that some of the dance-like rhythmic life that you might have heard in some of those excerpts is, I think, definitely due to the influence of Balinese music. I don't think my music sounded like that so much before then. So actually, that's, you're picking up on something.
When you're writing, do you actually, the last few things you played for us, do you actually hear it in your head? And when you hear it live the first time, are you ever surprised that it doesn't sound exactly as you had it planned?
Well, the answer is yes and yes. It's my job to hear it in my head. That's the métier of being a composer. I always stretch what I can hear. There's a speculative quality sometimes in for example, the amount of simultaneous information that I think that can be presented and still be audible. So when you make the shift from the imaginary sounds to the real ones, as soon as you get into rehearsal, it's very often that there are surprises in the sense that you need to make adjustments. You need to tell some people to play louder, some people to play softer. But if I'm doing my job properly, the surprises won't be too drastic. Sometimes they're pleasant surprises. Wow, that sounds even better than I thought it would. The most frequent change I found I have to make is a gesture that occurs a lot in my music is amassing a huge amount of sound and then stopping it and letting it resonate. Either they're resonating percussion instruments or there are sustaining instruments holding a sound that's soft after an accumulation of very loud sound. And I've often found that those moments don't last long enough in live performance. I count how many beats they should be or just the length of time in my imagination. And I work on that really hard because the pacing is really important. It's what keeps the rhythmic life of the music sort of alive. And I often find that the physical realities of sound are such that sound reflects off the walls and it sort of rings in the space in a way that it takes longer to clear. So I very often added more beats or told the conductor to wait longer before going on in those places. That's one surprise that comes up often enough that I should anticipate it and I should write that in.
Thanks. I really enjoyed listening to your music and the Tibetan music. I just have a comment because it's so powerful. It seems to me that they're playing to the mountains. You know, you have to play it loud enough for the mountains to listen to. But I have a question about Beethoven because you talked at the beginning about marches, and it seemed that all you associated and demonstrated how Turkish marches influence Haydn and Mozart. I thought Beethoven was influenced by marches, and there's a, and this is just a vague memory from Reader's Digest or something, that the Marseillaise and Beethoven's symphonies have some similar motifs that are related to marches. I wondered if you could say something about European traditions of marches that also influence music.
That's a really good question, and I don't know the answer, in short. I got into a discussion of this with Ralph Locke, who wrote the book on exoticism, about whether the Turkish march in the Ninth Symphony really would have sounded Turkish to Beethoven, or whether it would have sounded Turkish to his listeners at the time, which are two different questions. And the Turkish fad had really peaked a long time before that. And the Haydn Military Symphony is not called the Turkish Symphony, it's called the Military Symphony. The Haydn was written right at the time when the Turkish fad was at its height. The Beethoven was written much later. But the Beethoven is called Turkish and the Haydn is called military. So it's a very good question. But here's my way of glossing over it. The sound of those percussion instruments only came into the Western orchestra because of Turkish music. So it's Turkish in its origin, whether or not the composer thought he was being Turkish or not. That's a way of not answering your question. It's a really good question, and Ralph Locke raises the question. There's two different things. Was the composer thinking about Turkishness or Javaneseness or fill in the blank is one question, and what would it convey to listeners is another question, and you could divide that into how would it be perceived by listeners at that time versus how we perceive it now. So there are people who earn their living thinking and writing about things like this, and I'm finding it completely fascinating, so I refer you to them.
I have two questions. I'm afraid there's a good chance that the answer to both is no, but I'll still try to raise them. The first question is, for some reason, when I hear your music, it reminds me, I have the association with sunlight bursting through stained glass windows in French cathedrals. So I wonder if this is a totally off-the-mark association. And the second question is, in your quest for finding traces of this gamelan music in Western music, I was suddenly reminded of the beginnings of many pieces by Errol Garner. Errol Garner, jazz pianist, and where he kind of stumbles, and then suddenly, bang, he takes off.
Okay, I'm not familiar with that pianist, did you say?
Yeah.
So now you made me very curious. So the first question, it's a really interesting image of the stained glass window, because that is the image that my teacher Messiaen applied very consciously to his music. He was a synesthesist. He had synesthesia. He saw colors when he heard sounds. And the colors that inspired him most were the colors of Chartres and Notre Dame and the great rose windows of French cathedrals. So he felt that what he was doing in his music was actually trying to embody that in sound. I hadn't thought of my own music that way, but Messiaen is one of many strong influences in my music and search for harmony, rich harmony that is, I don't see colors the way he did, but harmony that I would consider colorful, a color that's, and music that's luminous. These are all metaphors for me. I do relate to that. It's part of my quest. In terms of this, the second question, that's very interesting. The idea of a slow, unformed, unmeasured introduction to something that then settles into something with a fixed rhythm is very common in many cultures. Turkish music, for example, in classical music, what's the word for it? Does anybody know the improvisatory beginning to a Turkish piece? I've been talking too long. It's a word I know well. I wish Zev were here. So a Turkish composed piece will be preceded by an unmeasured, that is no beats, improvisation in that makam, in that mode, as a prelude to the piece. It'll come to me as soon as you all disperse, what that's called. In Indian music, that's a very high art. It's called the alap. And it's before, if you hear Ravi Shankar give a performance, any instrument, a vocalist or instrumentalist in Indian traditions, they will play without the tablas, without drums, for quite a long time sometimes, without any beats, gradually exploring the deep meaning and the coloration of the raga or the mode. And then the second half of the piece is when the drums enter and they introduce rhythmic cycles. So if this jazz musician is doing this, he could be influenced by the way gamelan pieces begin, Arabic, Turkish or Persian classical music, Indian music, and probably many other traditions. It's a very interesting archetype that recurs all over the world.
I have a question about the difference maybe in the Turkish and the Arabic influences in Western music. Can you just clarify what the differences were, and were they actually based on something informed, or was it diluted?
That's a really rich question. Zev Feldman said to me, and it's in Ralph Locke's book, that most of the conventions that were identified as Turkish in 18th century music were an invention. They were a kind of a fantasy, conventionalized, exotic trope. But they were based on something. I think I showed you that. They weren't based on absolutely nothing. I have an example here that about the Arabic thing. There was a fascination beginning in the middle of the 19th century with French composers in because of the French colonies in North Africa in particular, in Arabic culture. And I just became acquainted with a piece by a now forgotten composer named Félicien David called Le Désert, the desert, which is a big oratorio about the 2 years he lived in Egypt. And it has nothing overtly Arabic sounding about the music, but it's quite expert at evoking the feeling of space and peace. And there's a very ornate tenor solo called the Call of the Muezzin, which doesn't sound like Arabic music in terms of the specifics, but it has the gesture of the very ornate incantation type of singing. That piece, which is now forgotten, was hugely influential among French and Russian composers. And so I can show you an example here from Rimsky-Korsakov. This is a piece that I am deeply in love with. I played it in my college orchestra. I played bass drum. It's called Antar, and it's based on Arabian folk tales. And I read recently that some of these melodies, like the one I'm going to play you, which have augmented seconds, the real markers of Middle Eastern music, were taken from transcriptions of Arabic melodies that Rimsky-Korsakov actually found. So in the later 19th century, some of the evocations of the Arab world really are based on something. Let's see. That's all you need, right? So this gets into the idea of the arabesque, these very ornate melodies. In this case, it may actually be an Arab melody, and it has the characteristic modal quality, the augmented seconds, and also this free ornamental quality. Debussy deeply loved this work. He wrote about it many times over. And the passage, just to come full circle here, the passage from The Afternoon of a Faun that I tried to dissect for you is modeled almost measure for measure on a passage from this work of Rimsky-Korsakov, including the threes against twos accompanying the melody. It's in the same key. It's a similar melody. It's an overt homage to Rimsky-Korsakov. Also, Scheherazade. It's the most famous example of that. It's based on the 1001 Nights and does not include any obviously Arabic-sounding music, less than Antar, but it does include arabesque-type melodies. The opening violin solo of Scheherazade. There are French operas like Delibes' Lachmée and Samson and Delilah of Saint-Saëns, all of which have this sense of the Orient, meaning the Middle East, as the exotic other are fundamental in those pieces. And there are specific musical traits. So there's that, and then there's the general idea, more generalized idea of the arabesque that Debussy was in love with. So my theory about the augmented seconds is that 18th century composers were too tied to the major-minor system to hear that as actually music. When harmony developed and broadened 100 years later, composers were ready to embrace that. And they were typically not the German composers. They were the French and the Russian. And those two streams became the source that Debussy drew on. He was very indebted to the Russians. And that fed to Stravinsky and directly to Messiaen, who was an heir of all of those things. It's the other tradition other than the one that Stravinsky called the German stem. He hyphenated the names of all the composers. It went Bach, Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven, Schumann, Schubert, Brahms, Wagner. It's like, what, one name. And Stravinsky said, that's another tradition. I'm at an angle from that. So most of what we're talking about here after the Turkish phase in Vienna has been actually part of that other tradition. Thank you all for staying so long. Was there any...